I'd like to start by asking you about your first research experiences.
Well, I think the way to handle this is to actually say my first research experience, you might say, were vicarious. I was a high school student who actually had a hobby interest in archaeology. And I didn't know what social or cultural anthropology was or what ethnography was, but my sister married a graduate student in anthropology from Yale at a very interesting time in the development of one of the schools of anthropology. And she went off to Malaya at that time in like 1960-61 to study an Aboriginal people really in the deep jungle, the Samai. And what she produced for us, those of us who remained home, were letters from the field. And so I read her letters during those 2 years with great fascination and interest. And it actually, that was my first experience in the field, through the vicarious experience of learning about these people and learning about what field work was and how you learned about them. It was supplemented with a kind of informal education about who Malinowski was or Samai was, but very high school kind of stuff, but very deep, because I came from a small town and the idea would be, oh, did you want to be doctor, lawyer, corporate executive, I guess, or something like that. So it really did change. In archaeology, I enjoyed, but not with the passion that letters from the field turned me onto. So that's where, okay. So I went to Yale as an undergraduate, and actually its anthropology program was going through a certain kind of transition there. And I actually didn't think it was the place to go as an undergraduate to really get a great education at that time. So I didn't major in anthropology. I did a different kind of major in politics and economics, which was really dealing with, at that time, post-war economics, the economic development, et cetera. But my back beat, and I let the people in the program know, was always to go on in anthropology. So I wasn't going to use this to go on to be a lawyer, to wind up working for George Bush someday, by the way, who was in my class. But that's what happened to most of the graduates in that program. They didn't go on to be scholars. There were a couple. But my aim, so I had this imaginary of working in anthropology from very on, and the imaginary was not the fascination with the primitive or the fascination with the object of anthropology. Although, of course, I was interested. It was fascinating, but it wasn't my passion. My passion was the experience of fieldwork itself, the idea that you could immerse yourself in another culture which challenged you personally in various ways, but also showed you just wondrous things about people and ambiguous things and just extraordinarily rich. So I went through Yale, and my intention was always to go on in anthropology, but at which I knew the definition of the anthropologist was one who had, in training, done field work. So more than, I knew that ethnography existed in sociology and some other fields, but it was emblematic and central to the, just like psychoanalysis, central to the making of a Freudian psychiatrist or something like that, heaven help me with that. I saw it as central to the making of anthropology. So how this goes on as a bit of a story is that I won the Henry Fellowship at Yale and I went to Cambridge for a year. And the English were known as people who invented a very rigorous form of the ethnographic method after, you know, Malinowski and many prominent people like Edmund Leach, and that they debated their work in terms of field work results. So I had known a little bit of English anthropology, but I read anthropology for a year at Cambridge. But just as anthropology there in its paradigm, its classic function was falling apart. And I sustained my interest in anthropology, not because of the dying, well, I mean, this is a big, the dying ideas of British anthropology, but because of, once again, the intimacy of which you can learn of the intimacy of fieldwork experiences. So, as usual, I was less interested in the results than in the kind of semi-biographical stories of ethnographers. And that's basically continued in England. So while I found the materials kind of, I took them in, the history of the institution, which was the history of you know, one field worker after another, was of interest to me. So what happened to me was this was the Vietnam War period, and I was I could not resist unless I did resist, so I was drafted. And I spent 2 years in the Army, but fortunately I spent them in South Carolina. I was a Jewish chaplain's assistant, an ideal job in the Army, but it allowed me to teach anthropology at the University of South Carolina part-time as an adjunct, even though I had no graduate training or anything. But there was someone there doing very interesting field work, an older anthropologist trained by Melville Herskovitz on the Sea Island Gullah-speaking black people of the Carolinas, an island which became very famous called Dalfuski Island. It's changed a lot since then. And so it was an opportunity, actually, when I was in the Army to do actual real field work.